So I was thinking about ice, water, and water vapor. They're all water, right? They're all H2O, but they're very different. And the transition from one to the other can be very dramatic, like boiling water or ice melting, or it can be very hard to see, like water evaporating out of a dish. Those are all examples of tipping points.
So take ocean acidification. It's been happening for a long time. We didn't realize it until very recently. And then just in the last, I would say, literally 18 to 24 months, there's been kind of a social tipping point in certain communities, not globally, where all of a sudden there's a recognition that, wow, this is bigger than, you know, just some climate issue in the oceans. It's actually impacting my pocketbook, or it's impacting my community in very precise and very defined ways.
And how did that happen? How did you see this sort of social phenomenon occurring that you call a tipping point?
For me, wearing my political hat, it was the first time ever that we had a direct linkage between a climate issue and jobs. And so I think when the shellfish growers approached a handful of us in elected office and said, something is happening and we are literally going to begin moving jobs from Washington State to Hawaii because your water has a problem. There was this sea change in thought that, okay, so we've got to get in front of this. And before that, that hadn't taken place. And I think it was because instead of it being an environmental issue, instead of it being a big eye glaze climate issue, there was a direct linkage to jobs.
Well, let me give you a tipping point that I was involved in. It was the banning of DDT. I was the administrator of the Environmental Protection Agency when it was banned. It was my decision. On the basis of everything I've been able to discover since that time, raptors that were having this egg thinning phenomenon as a result of DDT have recovered. Now, for them, that was a tipping point. Now, you could talk about a tipping point on the other side. Those who were no longer allowed to use DDT saw it as a interference with their ability to use a very effective pesticide. But that was there was no question that was the tipping point.
What was the role of scientists in that?
Crucial. The statute regulating pesticides, the same statute that exists today, is called the Federal Insecticide, Fungicide, and Rodenticide Act. Isn't that a wonderful guy? I love saying that. Sounds like I know what I'm talking about. But any society has to locate the responsibility for making those decisions somewhere. And to the extent that science is a very important part of making that judgment, it puts science in the right place. It develops the facts, the background for making a judgment about risk and benefits.
Well, the tribes have experienced tipping points on many levels since the arrival of the first non-native people. In our area, the destruction of the old growth redwood rainforest, which has had profound effects on all the different parts of our ecosystem, terrestrial and marine. So the tipping point there was that things had to get so bad and so incredibly drastic and have so much direct action and legal action taking place that before we could wake up lawmakers to make some, you know, additional improvements to the California Environmental Quality Act.
We've been looking at this, and actually Puget Sound's another good example that have been working on this, a portfolio of early change indicators and those that change more slowly. Because like you say, there's really good information about what parts of the ecosystem might be changing over slow time periods that we need to keep track of. So you need short-term indicators, and you need longer term ones. And putting together that package so you can communicate to people what's happening, but also scientifically be able to keep track of the overall durability of the system to withstand these shocks and back and forth is a good science art. So it's science and communication, I'd say.
So I think that analogy is exactly why we're not doing enough. Bill, when you started at the EPA, people didn't freak out till the river was on fire. You know, the green sludge coming out of the pipe made my kid sick, right? So It's like the crisis creates community. How do you galvanize a population around an issue without the crisis? Or how do you maintain that interest, that involvement after the crisis?
Right, so I agree with you that it's very important not to waste crises, because a crisis is one of the few times that a number of people pay attention to things that they're not paying attention to. But you're a politician, and you know about potholes. How do we find the potholes so that before the bridge falls down, we notice that the ride on it is very rough? So the question is, how do you find something that will get people's attention, the mass of people? So it's not just figuring out what the right indicators are, it's actually getting that to resonate with people.
And in California, we now know from recent studies that the most engaged leaders in environmental protection right now are minorities. So I think we can tailor our approaches based upon that knowledge, that there is already going to be receptiveness on some levels there. So we have to find out how we're going to educate more people and policymakers and others that can influence even larger changes, because the people themselves aren't going to be able to do that alone.
This idea of educating people before there's a crisis and getting them to be passionate before there's a crisis, be they a lawmaker or somebody else that's going to be a leader in these discussions, yeah. I think that's fundamental.
If we can infuse at an early age, then we can avoid a lot of the fights that we might otherwise have to engage in and waiting until disasters happen, because we have then populations that are already in their minds and hearts invested in taking care of the earth and understanding why it's important to them in their lifetime and then for future generations as well.